introduced this summer. Today I would like to introduce Dr. Marni LaFleur. She's an assistant professor at the University of San Diego, starting there this fall, and has been working a lot at the University of California, San Diego as well. She is the founder and director of Lemur Love, which is a 501c3, which aims to inspire a love for wild lemurs and help to aid in their conservation and protection in the wild. She has a PhD from the University of Colorado at Boulder. She also did a postdoc at the Veterinary University of Vienna after that, and she is a member of the IUCN Primate Specialist Group, helping to advocate for non-human primates. So today she's going to be talking to us about the impact of the pet trade on ring-tailed lemurs, and welcome Marni.
Thank you to everybody for being here. I was thinking it's the middle of summer. Who's going to go to a talk? Lots of people here, so thanks for coming. Okay, so first thing, I'm going to tell you first why I'm sort of interested in this lemur pet trade, what got me interested in that. Really briefly, just mentioned lemur biodiversity. I'm sure most of you in this room are quite well aware of lemur biodiversity. I'll again briefly mention the threats to their survival, and then look at the most recent threat, which is the trade of wild captured lemurs. So I'll outline what I mean by pet lemur and discuss the actual captures. Then talk about illegal lemurs, which are individually owned, so owned by individual people. And take a bit of an in-depth look at ring-tailed lemurs specifically. And then I'll talk about legal lemurs, sort of pet lemurs, which are facility-based in Madagascar. And then sort of wrap up with a few lessons learned. So my apologies in advance that this talk isn't really all that polished, and the reason for that is because I'm just back from Madagascar about 2 and a bit weeks, and I had an abstract. Actually, I was supposed to give a talk here last year at this time, and I got really sick, and it didn't work out. So I had to cancel. And so I was planning to do a similar talk on that theme, but when I came, you know, I'm back and I've got all these things fresh in my mind, that seemed really boring. So I'm talking about some things that are sort of newer that I'm sort of delving into research-wise, but I have less of a sort of a handle on these things, so that's where we're at. Okay, so I'll tell you how I got interested in the lemur pet trade, or studying the lemur pet trade. This little guy here, his name was Sid, and when I was doing my dissertation work in Madagascar, I lived in a forest where we camp, and so there's no facilities other than tents there. And one day, after I had been in this forest for I think about 8 months or so, a park official came on a motorbike with a guy from a village about an hour away, and they had a none too happy lemur with a rope tied around his waist, and they gave him to me, or they were given to me, they left him with me. So this was a pet lemur that had become aggressive, and people in the village, the owner was afraid that they were going to kill him, and he had had some of his fingers amputated from people because he was getting into so much trouble, and he was just really problematic for the village. So they brought him to me, and of course, I have no capability to care for a lemur in my tent, so that didn't work out very well. On about the third or fourth day, he actually escaped, and I lost him. I never saw him again. And he couldn't have survived. He didn't know how to eat normal food. He didn't know how to get water or anything. So that was really hard for me. I felt really bad for him. And he was a real handful, but a sweet animal. But it wasn't his fault, right? None of this was his fault. And one of the memories that I have of him, he had really bad fleas. And so I was feeding him garlic to try to get him his fleas to go away, because I mean, he's spending a lot of time really close to me, and I'm getting fleas, and you know, I didn't want these fleas everywhere. But when he would settle down in the night, when he was tired and would actually settle down for like 20 minutes a day, he would want to groom me. So he would use his little tooth comb and scratch at my face and try and lick me, but he had garlic breath. So he was really sweet, but this was one of the things that got me interested in this. And the second, this is Mowgli here. Mowgli was 9 months old in that picture, and he was taken from the park where I work, from one of the lemur groups that I habituated. So this is one of the problems with habituating wild animals, especially when you aren't there all year round, is that they are more susceptible to things like this, like capture. And so Mowgli is actually at a rescue center now. He was transferred there when he was quite young, so he has a fairly decent quality of life, but he still will have to live his entire life in a rescue center. So these are sort of my entrances into the study of pet lemurs. Okay, so lemur biodiversity. As you may well know, lemurs are an extraordinarily diverse group of primates found only on the island of Madagascar. Some of the reasons that they're so diverse is because they had a really long isolation from other land masses, so they evolved over about 65 million years under island conditions. And this led to the adaptive radiation of 113 extant species, and of course there are also 17 species that have gone recently extinct, including the giant lemurs. And they have a number of traits that are really unusual. So female dominance is one, and I've spent much of my academic career investigating this because I find it particularly interesting. Synchronized weaning, low basal male metabolic rates, ephemerality, nocturnal full livery, and the eye-eye. I just like to say that the eye-eye is just unusual enough to have its own section there. Okay, so threats to lemur survival, these are not particularly unusual. They're a lot of the same threats that animals see worldwide. But lemurs are said to be the most threatened group of mammals on Earth. 94% is what is the published value that are at risk of extinction. I was at the Red List workshop for lemurs in May, and this will actually, we've recommended that this be increased to 97% are actually at risk of extinction, but this is pending approval by the board. So primary threats to lemurs include deforestation, and there's a couple of different types of deforestation. One is looking for really big, precious hardwoods and taking out these highly valuable trees. The other is more of a subsistence use or widespread taking of lower quality items just to for subsistence. The next threat is bushmeat hunting, and so again, this happens by way of subsistence hunting, but also somewhat of a growing luxury bushmeat trade. So, is anybody familiar with this picture? Do you know what happened recently?
Somebody stole it. Did they steal it or did he?
Oh, well, this is also in the news, actually. I think this was at the Santa Barbara Zoo, that somebody stole the lemur and it was found in a hotel lobby with a note saying, I guess they cut through a capuchin cage and they cut through a lemur cage, let the capuchins go, took the lemur, took it like 100 miles away and left it in a hotel lobby with a note saying, I belong at the Santa Barbara Zoo. So that's totally different than this, but this was just in the news this morning. This was a bushmeat haul that was intercepted, I think in March. It was 10 Indri and 1 Dieting Shifaka. So if you know either of these species, they're critically endangered. They have really slow life histories. Each animal is really important, so it's really hard when something like this happens. And there isn't a lot of, we don't really know what was going on, but we know that local officials were involved and it was probably for some sort of a luxury bushmeat. For luxury bushmeat. Okay, and then perhaps most recently, the live capture for individual pets or facility-based animals. So what I'm going to do is just demonstrate that this is not something that has been recognized in the literature or recognized by people who sort of work with lemurs until quite recently. So you may be familiar with the lemurs of Madagascar, which is sort of the Bible of lemurs, which has several authors, but Russ Mittermeier is the first author. And he says in his book, although visitors may see an occasional lemur kept as a pet by local people, this is not usually a cause for major concern. And this was, the latest edition is in 2010, so that's a fairly recent, fairly recently that these are not thought to, it's not really thought to be a threat. And it shows here a picture of a girl with a bamboo lemur. this was a paper from 2014 that has been quite well cited. And I'm actually a co-author on this, and live capture is not mentioned as a threat. So from 2014, we didn't realize or didn't recognize that live capture was a threat. And one of the little excerpts from this paper, community-based management, ecotourism, and researchers' presence are proposed to prevent lemur extinctions. So true, but we hadn't or didn't acknowledge the role that tourism may play in live captures. Okay. So, just to demonstrate that this is really quite recent, what I will then do today is outline the extent of our knowledge on this threat now and argue that it does pose a significant threat to the survival of lemurs, some species particularly, and discuss the role of tourism and tourists in this. Okay, so the first thing that I need to sort of lay out is what is a pet lemur. So in several publications, we've defined a pet lemur as being a lemur that is perceived to be owned by an individual or a business, has been removed from its natural habitat, or relies on humans for food. So this is a really broad definition of what it means to be a pet lemur. And it's not always a really good definition. It doesn't fit everything. So for example, pretty much any lemur that is not wild in Madagascar would then be considered a pet, but this doesn't, this just doesn't work for everything. So for example, Park Iluina, where captive breeding takes place, these animals are provisioned. So they're dependent on humans for food, but we don't think of them as pets. So this is kind of, there's kind of an awkwardness to this, but that's the definition I'll continue to use anyhow. Okay, so live capture of lemurs, what we know. The vast majority of lemurs that are captured in Madagascar stay within Madagascar. So I only have two instances in the recent past or in the recent history of exports of lemurs. So one was for the Duke Lemur Center in 2017, and this was from a breeding pair of blue-eyed black lemurs that were captive born. This was the first export in 24 years for the US. So this is quite rare. And there was an attempted illegal export of six ewe lemur. They weren't all the same species, but they were all ewe lemur. Also in 2017. But there's no other known cases, so I've not found any other news cases, any other reports, anything else from the government indicating that anyone is trying to get lemurs out of Madagascar. So this trade is happening within Madagascar, and they're going to a couple of different places, as I've said, individually owned lemurs and then facility-based lemurs. Okay, so of the individually owned lemurs, almost all of these are illegal. So it is illegal to have, buy, trade, keep a lemur in Madagascar, unless you have special permission. You can get special permission as an individual, but that's only after you already have an illegal lemur, and only under particular circumstances that involve some corruption. So it's not really, you can't really get permission, but you can. So for example, I know somebody who doesn't live in Tanu, who lives in a city on the west coast that had a pet lemur that wanted the lemur to get treatment in the capital city. And so they were able to get legal permission to keep this lemur so that the lemur could fly once a year to the capital city and be treated by the vet. So if you've got friends in the right places, you can potentially get permission to keep your animal, but you can't just go and say, oh, I want to get a pet lemur, I need permission to do this. It doesn't, you can't, unless you know the right person to, right, I guess. So it's estimated that there were, that between 2010 and 2013, there were approximately 28,000 pet lemurs in Madagascar. So, as I said, these individually owned lemurs, all of these captures are illegal, and there's no breeding programs for these animals. So all of these animals are wild captured, they're not being bred anywhere. Okay, so legal facilities. There are, as of 2016, there were 14 legal facilities holding 645 lemurs. Some of the captures are legal. I would argue or suspect that some of the captures are not legal, and I'll explain a little bit more about that in a bit. Breeding occurs on site, or may occur on site. It may be somewhat managed, or very well managed, as it is at Parque Marina, but it may be not managed. And so for a lot of these facilities that you go to, there's hybrids or animals breeding that they really don't want or really don't need in their collection. They're just breeding because they're there. At illegal facilities, it's really unknown as to how many of these are, but I know of at least 11 additional facilities holding animals. These are relatively well known. You can find them in a guidebook. Says there's got to pick up lemurs there, you can go visit. Nobody's upset about these places, monitoring them, anything like that. All of their captures will be illegal. And again, breeding may occur on site, this isn't managed, and a lot of the animals may be hybrids. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about actual captures. So, legal captures, it's possible to get permission from the government of Madagascar to capture wildlife or wild lemurs or other wildlife in Madagascar. So even for critically endangered species, this is possible. So I just visited a resort called the Palmarium where they have a number of INRI species on their very small property. And in 2014, they were given permission to capture and transport 4 INRI, which are critically endangered. And it's also possible to get permission to collect endangered or critically endangered animals in protected areas. So the II, or the Palmarium also has 7 II. 5 of them were captured in the Marshwala Peninsula, which is a protected area, which is a national park. And so other examples, the main zoo in Antananarivo, Zimbazaz, they routinely have permission to wild capture. Another resort called Kimoni, they get permission to capture. So lots of these places can access permission to capture wild animals. And some of these captures are animals that are not likely to survive. So you can see in this little picture here, there's some microcebus that were at Zimbazaz. And as you may well know, it's difficult for first generation wild captured animals to survive. So the transition is really hard for these guys, and the mortality rates are really high. These are Varus shifaka at Kimoni. So Kimoni is in the western dry forest, so it's actually possible that these guys could have done okay in this area because the plants there, they may be able to survive the plants there. But in 2015, Zimbazaz Zoo actually wild captured 6 Varus shifaka. In 2016, 1 was remaining, and that one died in 2016. So animals that are being captured aren't necessarily going. I could have told you that these shifaka didn't survive in Antananarivo because they don't have the right plants. And simply because it's hard to go from being a wild animal to being a captive animal. And this one, this is a species of leppy lemur that is native to the area of Morungav, where this Kimoni resort is. And this guy, leppy lemur are known to survive more than 30 days in captivity. So we know that this animal would have died because he's an EKG, can't survive like that. So I don't know, there's a lot of ambiguities here, and you don't always know if they had legal permission to capture that animal, if they captured it illegally, if they always have a leppy lemur. So are they continuing to capture these animals every 20 days or however long it takes for them to die? Or was this just a one-off and somebody brought it to them? I don't really know. Okay, I'm sorry for the graphic nature of some of these photos. So I've told you that there's no breeding for any of these lemurs for the individually owned or facility-based lemurs, unless it's the special case for the ones where they actually are breeding, but that's a bit of an aside. So, and little organized breeding for legally owned facility-based lemurs, okay. So, little is known about about wild captures that are illegal, because these are really clandestine in nature, right? They're people aren't going out and about and chatting about these a lot because they're really productive. Things that we know or that we suspect is that lemurs can be ordered from catchers or smugglers. What likely were orders have been intercepted, and captures likely have high mortality, particularly when infants are targeted. So in these pictures here, can anybody see what that is? Not really. It's a mouse lemur living in a plastic bottle. So this was for sale. And this is was a half lemur that was a pet that I don't know what happened to it, but obviously it died. Okay, so illegal live capture examples. So I've gotten reports, I get lots of emails from people telling me things, and I've gotten several about a person in a certain area that I'll just read you a few little excerpts about it. This lemur catcher, as they're referred to, transports shivakas via taxi grooves. Methods used are extremely cruel, dehydration, gags, sacks, etc. Mortality is a big problem for captive shivaka in some resorts. So the picture that I'm getting here is that people really like to interact, especially with shivaka. I mean, they're amazing. They're beautiful animals. People really like them. And so there are these resorts that want to keep shivaka because they keep people coming in. But they're hard to keep. And a lot of these places don't have experienced staff that know how to care for them, that know how to address illness. So they don't last very long. And so they want to keep a somewhat steady flow of these animals in their collections. And so there are people that they can go to order live captures of them. Okay, live capture interceptions of animals. So in 2014, 5 II's were intercepted in a rural village in Madagascar. They were treated for dehydration and some wounds, so they had lacerations, and these poor guys were pretty beat up. The surviving animals were transferred to the park Ibluin, and I couldn't find how many actually survived, but Dean, do you know how many survived?
2 were still at the facility, and 1 yeah. Free ranging around.
Okay, so 3 of them survived, but I think 2 didn't make it.
They were in pretty bad shape.
So 3 of them survived, but 2 didn't. And of course, San Diego Zoo participated in this rescue, and also, I believe, financed and facilitated the enclosures at Hibumi. So we don't exactly have evidence for this, but these animals were likely ordered, captured, and then en route to potentially a legal facility. I don't think we'll ever really know the whole story, but people don't tend to capture highly prized animals and have them being transported somewhere for no reason. You don't tend to do that for not any money or not any reason. So I think it's fairly likely to presume that this is what's going on. Okay, and then talking about infants and specifically ring-tailed lemurs in this case. So ring-tailed lemurs have really highly synchronized reproduction. That means that infants are born in Madagascar, infants are born in late September or early October every year. And they nurse for at least 4 months. So the earliest onset of weaning would take place in late January. But infants are captured for the holiday season for tourists. So a lot of tourists come to Madagascar in December over the holidays. And some like to see lemurs, or it's perceived that they like to see lemurs. So the infants are captured. And then you'll see these infants present on beaches and at local tourist destinations. But they don't do so well because, of course, in December they should still be nursing for another 2, 3, even 4 months. I've seen animals still nursing in late March. So they don't survive very well. You can see from this photo that poor little one is not doing so great. And words that people have used to describe these infants on pet lemur survey, which I'll talk to you about next, include dehydrated, dirty, floppy, near death. So these little guys what do you expect? They're still nursing, right? They're just babies, so they really don't do very well, and their survivorship is quite low. Okay, so about individually owned illegal lemurs. So this initiative, Pet Lemur Survey, was undertaken by my colleague, Dr. Kim Ruder. in 2013, and she started in the northern regions of Madagascar. And then we continued this survey work collaboratively and across Madagascar in 2016. So in total, we had a little more than 1,700 household surveys from 22 administrative units. And some of the main results, about 36% of people said they had seen a pet lemur. About 4% of people said that they had owned a pet lemur, either currently or at some time in the past. And from this, we extrapolated or estimated that there were this very large range, about 33,000 pet lemurs in the 6 months before this survey in 2016. And the range on that is huge, 8,000 to 57,000. This is not a very precise number. But point being that we're talking about thousands of animals, not hundreds and not hundreds of thousands. Probably talking about in the low thousands of animals. So even though that this may not be huge numbers for certain species, even small numbers of captures, live captures, could impact the population viability. So you've got a nervous shifaka here sitting on the ground with a cat looking at it. And we know that these guys, I've told you already, these guys have really low survivorship. And at the Red List workshop for lemurs that I mentioned, all shifaka have been elevated to critically endangered. So that's not official yet, but it will be put to the board for approval. So this, even a few captures of these guys could be problematic, especially because they don't survive. Okay, so a little bit more in depth about ring-tailed lemurs. So these are the most frequently reported pet lemur, with 28% of all lemur sightings being ring-tailed lemurs. These have been reported more than 1,000 kilometers away from their natural range. So as far away as you can get from their range, the very tip of Madagascar, we've got reports of pet ring-tailed lemurs there. And okay, so what I did for from the pet lemur survey data is looked at reports of all lemurs, so all lemur reports. So in total, there were 1,300 reports, a little more than 1,300, which most people had reports of a number of animals, so this was thousands of pet lemurs from 32 species. And specifically looking then at just ring-tailed lemurs, what I wanted to get at was which ones were unique. So I have all of these reports of individual animals, but if you think of a popular tourist destination or somewhere that's right on the freeway or something like that, you might have a number of people reporting the same animal. So it could look like there's a lot more animals than there actually are. So what I did was really carefully went through each of these and tried to identify which were likely unique animals. And from that, I got down to 286 individuals from 180 reports. Okay, and so looking at a little bit more of the information coming from these animals, there were a few hot spots, and these include popular tourist destinations. So Tuliar had the most. Anacau, which is a small beach community just south of Tuliar, had the second most. And Fort Defend, which is in the very south of the island, had the third most number of lemurs. And then just a little bit more information about these guys. So motivations for ownership, why people want to or procure lemurs. About half of them is because they want to make money off of them. So they either have a restaurant and they want to bring their lemur in and then think that that will lure more people in, or they want to approach tourists for photo ops and charge people a small amount of money to take pictures or to play with the animal. And then just slightly less want to have them just for the sake of having them. They just want to have a pet lemur. About half of these were associated with businesses. So the person either took them to a restaurant, or the animal lived at a restaurant or a hotel or something like that. About 40% lived in private residences, and 13% are reported as other. So either they're reported by somebody who only saw them on the beach, or who only saw them on the street, or some just set in another location, so we don't really know what that is. And as for general conditions that these animals are living in. Most are either caged or tethered, so one of the most common is just a rope around the middle and they're tied to something, or in a small cage. But cages are kind of hard to come by in Madagascar. People don't really have cages for a lot of reasons, so you have to kind of go out of your way to get a cage and either make it or have it made by somebody. 72% of the cages were considered too small by those that reported them, so that's a relative measure as to their assessment of what they thought of the living conditions. 81% of these animals are alone, and we know that most lemur species are social animals, so that's not good for them. And then a little over half were considered to be in poor health. So it's not really a great life for these animals. I'm sorry, it's a real Debbie the Downer kind of a tough day. Okay, so one of the things that we've been doing to try and get a better handle on this is determine the locations for the capture. So I told you that ring-tailed lemurs are the most reported pet lemurs, so we think that these are the species that is most impacted by this trade. So what we've been doing is trying to figure out where they're coming from. So there are 8 known remaining wild populations of ring-tailed lemurs with more than 100 individuals. So just 8 locations where these are most likely coming from. Of course, they could come from locations with far fewer animals, but this is what we're starting with here. So over the last couple of years, my colleagues and I have collected fecal samples from ring-tailed lemurs at all of these 8 sites. And now we're creating a genetic map from microsatellite DNA, microsatellite markers, to sort of understand the markers that are present in different populations. We've also sampled 37 of these pet lemurs, and what our goal is to figure out where those pets have come from. So results are expected soon, like this month, I hope. And so this will help us figure out how to best sort of move forward with addressing this trade. So is it happening from one site and with some really targeted messaging and perhaps enforcement be the best way to target this? Is it happening just a little bit everywhere? And so would a more widespread approach be better? These are the results that we're hoping to figure out. And this method could quite easily be adapted to other species that are also impacted by this trait. Okay, so facility-based lemurs, and because that clock is, I just want to check the time. Legal life captures and keeping of lemurs in facilities. So I've told you that there are these 14 legal facilities with 645 legal captive lemurs. 2 of these are rescue facilities. Their primary goal is to take in and rehabilitate, although that hasn't yet happened, but take in animals that are part of the pet trade. 1 is for captive breeding and also a zoological park, so this is in Lumina. 1 is straight up a zoo, so that's in Mazaz. And the remaining 10 are tourist attractions. So 4 of these have hotels alongside with them, so you can actually go stay at these hotels and see the lemurs that they have. 6 of them don't have accommodation, so it's more like a park that you go for the day and visit. And like I said, there's at least 11 more facilities that exist that are not considered legal, but these are well-known tourist sites. So the trade of these lemurs within this type of facility is not limited just to the ones that we know are legal. Okay, so there's a bunch of problems with keeping these lemurs. Doesn't apply to every facility, but it applies to many of the ones that are more targeted towards tourists. So animal care and management are really inconsistent, and species knowledge is variable. So at some places, the staff and the caregivers have really good knowledge about the animals and about what's appropriate for those animals. At some places, they don't even know what species it is, where the species aren't identified correctly on signage, and that knowledge just isn't there. Permission to capture and keep can be solely based on the facility's desire to have a specific animal. So I'm going to show you a minute or a video here in a minute. I have Yeah. So I've told you examples of lemurs that are highly unlikely to survive, but if a facility wants to have those animals, even though they're not likely to survive, they can likely get permission to have them. And captures of critically endangered species are permitted simply for the tourist interaction. So it doesn't have to be because you want to protect them, because you want to breed them, because you want to make sure they're safe. It's because you want tourists to be able to directly interact with these animals. No national standards exist at this point. So some facilities are quite well managed, but others just completely do not have the knowledge to be able to address the animals' needs. And really, the animals' needs are not at the forefront of why they're even there. Collection planning and animal exchanges are very rare at best. They do happen. But again, this is, for most of the facilities, it's an afterthought, if at all. And again, this is driven by tourist interaction to interact, generally directly with the animals, and the owners of these sites desire to please their visitors. So let me see how, I don't know how, that's not it. So I've been mentioning this one place called the Palmarium a few times, and that's because I was just there to visit and see. I got a small grant to check out the conditions and see what's going on and collect samples from the Indri there, because as you may know, Indri cannot be, they cannot reproduce in captivity, so they're really only found in the wild. But this palmarium has breeding Indri, and they really only have a very small, very degraded forest, but the animals are surviving and reproducing. Now, I don't know if it's the same animals every year that are there, or if it's different animals, and I don't know what the survivorship of those infants are, but visits like this will help figure that out. So you can just see, how many people have seen an Indri? It's a really special experience. I mean, I love lemurs, of course, but I'm sure that everybody in this room has an animal that when you see in the wild, it just takes your breath away. Like, it's wonderful, and it's such an honor, and it's really humbling to see an animal that is so special like that. And that's what I feel like with Indri and also with high eyes. I just think they're so wonderful. But not everybody feels like that. And sometimes people walk into a forest and think that they can just touch an Indri or do whatever they want. So I'll just show this to you and sort of explain. So this is at the Palmarium, and this young man here has a camera. And this is a female Indri. She has a three-week-old baby on her back. So just before I started shooting this video, he tried to grab the baby because he was going to hold it and take its photo. And luckily, the guide was like, no, you can't, don't. But they didn't stop them from doing anything else. So both the young man, and I presume this is his mother that he's with, both were stroking the Indri, the female, on the head and on her back. The guy told him not to touch the baby, but if you saw the camera, he had it, maybe there was an inch and a half between the camera and the baby. So, I mean, this is the kind of interaction that these animals are getting. And the reason that she's down there and she's so curious about it is because about half of her diet is bananas. So the guides will lure them down with bananas and then give people bananas and people like put them in their mouth and, you know, take all kinds of photos. Put them on their head and get the Indri to climb on them. So this was fairly shocking to me. You know, I think of these as such majestic animals, and then somebody just walks up and they're going to grab a baby. Like, dear Jesus. That kid is watching this. This is my best behavior that day. Okay. So one of the things now that's going to be important for moving forward is really monitoring and assessing these legal captive animals. So there is an initiative by the Duke Lemur Center, which is great, that is looking to standardize animal care, train facility staff within country, and establish a code of ethics, among some other things. So this is really wonderful and very well needed. And then some of the things that I/Lemur Love plan to do is to monitor a select number of these facilities and their animals annually. So things that will be important to know is the number of animals present, and the age sex class of those animals, the conditions of the animal, the type of care provided, also to collect fecal samples for both population genetic studies, if these are needed, and also for gut microbiome. So one of the reasons that we believe that INRI and some of the chifaka and some of the nocturnal frugivorous lemurs cannot survive in captive conditions is because of changes in the diet, but also changes in the associated gut microbiome of those animals along with changes in the diet. So this will be important to understand conditions under which the animals are able to survive, like at the pomerium with the INRI I showed you, or perhaps where they're not. And so some of the aims of this, we want to understand if it's the same individuals year after year. So if I go back next year to the pomerium to see that injury, is it going to be the same mom? Is she going to have a baby? Or is it going to be a different female? And will she have a baby? Will she not have a baby? So to understand if there's a high turnover in these animals or if they're the same animals year after year. And if they are not the same animals year after year, where are they coming from? So how are they getting these animals? The effect of human contact and dietary changes on the animal well-being. So is there much of an impact that people are literally sort of manhandling these animals and feeding them by hand, or does this not really affect them? And what about the change in diet? How does this impact well-being? And also in order to form relationships with the owners and managers and staff of these places and to best advise when possible, when appropriate. Some people are very open to doing things the best way that they can. Not everybody is, but I think it's worth it a try. And this, also at the pomerium, an II. And so what they have is a private island that they built, private man-made island. And they have seven IIs living on this island. And so they do nightly tours where you have to take a boat to get to this island. And then they've set up these coconuts. And there's no contact with the animals, so there's a barrier, and you stand on, you know, maybe about 2 meters away and watch them feed on these coconuts. So the coconuts are placed there, they come to the coconut, they like to eat it, and then when they're done, they take off. But one of the things of interest, so when I went, there was, I think, 27 people, which I thought, dear God, 27 people, with, you know, only this few number of animals. It was okay, but what the staff told me was that in the peak of the high season, there can be easily 150 people per night. So, and they do it in multiple trips of bigger boats. So that's a lot of people going through. And so what they're doing, and aside, what they're also doing is making another man-made island. And what they said to me was that the animals need more space, that the island is too small, and for the seven animals, they need to have a bigger island. But I wonder if it's that, or if it's that they want to be able to bring in as many tourists as want to come, and so they're building this other island so that they can then get other IIs to bring in and accommodate more tourists. So I imagine the truth is sort of somewhere in the middle there. Okay, lessons learned. So I'm just wrapping up. So in general, the government of Madagascar is unwilling or unable to address lemur trafficking. That's been my experience. There is systematic corruption that really impedes any efforts from certain individuals. It just complicates everything and undermines any progress. And there are no insufficient facilities for placing confiscated or unwanted animals. So one of the arguments the government has said is, well, what are we going to do with them? Like, we go and we confiscate all these animals. There's two facilities on the island that could probably house about 60 individual lemurs. They are full. And we're going to go collect up 10,000 of them and put them where? Which, true, but that doesn't mean that we should have 10,000 lemurs out there. So captures, we really need some investigations of the less scrupulous types of captures and those that are involved. This is not something that I can necessarily do. Ideally, this would be by a wildlife trafficking external organization. So for somebody like me that wants to go to Madagascar potentially multiple times a year and conduct research, if I were to make a lot of noise and start doing investigations like this, I would be invited to not return. So that wouldn't really work out very well. Conservation interventions following determining where the ring-tailed lemurs are being captured, as I mentioned. And there's a need for further research on the magnitude of this trade, so we sort of have just, I think, kind of got to the tip of this iceberg. We really need more information. Improved care and survivorship of existing animals will definitely help. If the turnover isn't so high, there won't be a need to be recapturing as frequently. And increased awareness and behavior change in the tourist sector. So we really hope to get people thinking more about what practices they want to support with their dollars, where they want to spend their money, and what kind of impact that has on the animals, and whether or not these are sustainable for endangered species. Okay, so a lot of what I've talked about today, a lot of the literature you can either get through my personal website or Kim Ruder, who I mentioned earlier. And just wanted to note some funding sources. Of course, without these guys, we wouldn't be able to do any of this. And I just wanted to also show a couple of recent, this was a poster created by USAID that is, you can find all over Madagascar right now. There's lots of these posters around. So trying to get awareness about not directly interacting with lemurs, but rather not interacting with lemurs in forests, going to forests to see lemurs rather than going to places where they will jump all over you. And also the latest, probably most popular English travel guide from Madagascar also has information about the pet lemur trade and how to best not interact with those animals. Okay, thank you very much. And I think we've got a few minutes, correct? So yes, please.
It seems to me it would be a tough sell to convince people to go out in the forest and look at a lemur from afar when they could go to a place and interact directly. You know, have the lemur sit on their shoulder.
But here's the thing, though, is that most people that are seeking an eco-tourist experience are open to understanding what that actually means. So not everybody, some people want to go to a circus, certainly. But people that are going to Madagascar are looking for an adventure. They're looking to interact with rare animals that they don't see all the time, that they can't see anywhere in the world. And so I think that there is a real lack of understanding of what the cause and effect is here. I believe that if people have more information, they will act in different ways. What do you think?
Yeah.
Right? So I didn't know a lot. So 10 years ago, I went to one of these places where they jump all over you, and I was kind of uncomfortable because I thought like I was going to lose an eye. But I wasn't thinking, oh, this was a wild captured animal, and I wouldn't think anything like that. But, you know, I would never do that now. And I think a lot of people feel a lot more empowered with that information, and hopefully, you know, you're going all the way to Madagascar, it's costing you at least $10,000, and you, I think the way to sell this to people is that you're really going for that wild experience of these wild animals. You're not going so that you can see them at a restaurant, you know, on a road. That's not what people really want. We want that true experience, and that's how we need to sell it.
I seem to recall that the different religious and racial groups have different attitudes toward the animals. How does that affect the pet trade and capture and all that stuff?
Yeah, so there are different either taboos or traditional protections against some lemurs. But in my view, I think that has somewhat been eroded by just people being more migrant-based or being more mobile. And it does still affect some animals, but I think the taboos tend to be more against food. So in certain areas, like in the south where I work, people would never ever consider to eat a lemur. That is like, that just doesn't happen. But you might see them with a pet. So even though that they have respect for the animals and think, believe that their our ancestors may be in the spirits of these animals, it's I think, represented a little bit differently. But this isn't something that I have specifically researched.
The effort to try to source where these lemurs are coming from around the country seems amazing. And I wonder if you could comment a little bit on how you're going about that logistically in terms of some of the facilities potentially having illegal lemurs or the willingness of people to cooperate with allowing you to collect samples in order to get a large enough sample size to be able to...
So I've just started this. But what I've found thus far is that the facilities that are legal and have collected their animals legally are really willing to, they're like, hey, yeah, come on in. And then the staff are really interested. They want to ask questions about lemurs. And because they don't feel like they have anything to hide, and they don't. I mean, I'm not, well, maybe they do. But, you know, in theory, they don't feel like they, that I'm a bad guy and that they've got to protect what they're doing. They just feel like I'm interested in what they're doing, I can give them information, I'm fairly friendly, I don't yell at anybody, but sometimes I want to. So I've found them to be very receptive. I didn't feel that way at the resort called Kimoni, but I also didn't ask to collect samples there, just because it was much, it was just a totally different vibe. I am going to ask to collect samples there, but I don't know how that will go. So they are also legal, but I suspect that much of their acquisition is illegal and that they don't have great survivorship. So what I might find is that in facilities that need kind of the most work, they will probably be the least willing to open up. Yeah.
Are there any rules or regulations for pet lemurs here in the U.S.? Because recently I've seen quite a lot of pet lemurs on social media here in California and in Texas. And is there any regulations?
So, somebody might know more about California specifically. Who knows? Is this the LM? Do you know quite a bit about this? No, you don't. Okay. I thought you did. So you can get permission to have like service lemurs in California, but not a pet without the purpose of being a service animal. Which, what a terrible idea to have a service lemur. You are going to lose one or both of your ass one of these days. That is just not a good idea. So that it's possible. In Texas and in Florida, you can get a license to have these pets. The thing about pet lemurs within the U.S., of course their original stock is from Madagascar, but animals are not coming out of Madagascar to feed the U.S. domestic pet trade. So it is legal in some states, not a good idea at all. Just for the sake that these animals have anal scent glands and they rub them all over everything in your house, that's not going to, don't do that. That's what I tried to tell anybody that asked me about pet lemurs. Yeah. Yeah, it can be legal. Yeah.
Is there a good tourism company that you know of that takes people out into the forest, or is that something that would need to be, a business model would need to be created and distributed?
Yeah, there are. I don't have like a specific name for you. There are also, Duke does tours. There's tours through San Diego Zoo. I just think that if you're going and if you're doing that, you need to be really conscious of what's happening along the way. So a lot of times, like I said, things that I wouldn't have thought of before, we need to be thinking about where did these animals come from? What are their lives like? What do we think about this for sustainability? And we need to speak up. So if you're going somewhere and a guy pulls a banana out of his pocket, just tell him. And I mean, the more people that do that, the more they'll learn that they don't have to do that. I don't need a lemur to do tricks in order to be entertained. I'm perfectly happy to see it from, you know, half a kilometer away or whatever. Are we good? Everybody's hungry? Okay, thanks very much.